Today I'm going to give a very, very practical question, but this is based on the journal entries, and it also relates to the books of original entry, or sometimes it is also referred to as the prime books of account. Our books of prime account or prime books of accounts. Okay, so basically we're going to look at the books of original entry, and actually I'm going to explain to you so that I make them being aware, and we're also going to have some two or three journal entries so that you understand what we mean by books of original entry and the journal entries. Okay, my name is Kuruwa Mangana. I'm an assistant lecturer at the Open University of Tanzania, and I am the co-instructor of this course, OIF 101. And to make it easier for you to understand, we are going to use a certain question that was given in an exam with this course, OIF 101. And this was question number 2 that was given on 2018 May, question number 2. This question was having 2 parts. The first part was you were required to explain some of the subsidiary books or books of original entry that you know. You were supposed at least to mention 5 of them, or if not 5, at least 3 of them. And then part 2, you were given a number of business transactions, and then you are also required to come up with the journal entries. So that was the question all about. Part 1. You are supposed to explain books of original entry that you know, but part 2, you are given some of the economic events, some of the business transactions, and the task that you are given is for you to come up with the journal entries. Okay, now let us see the question and we go about it. Now let us start with part one. We're going to use this question to illustrate, and I hope at the end of this session, you'll be able at least to capture and be in a position of understanding some of the books of original entry. Okay? Books of original entry. Okay? Now, these books of original entry, or prime books of original entry, of course, these are the elementary books of accounts, whereby you're going to record all the transaction from the source documents. And by means of source document, you mean the receipts, the invoices, all those documents that normally it makes as a reference point whereby you're going to get the transactions that you're going to record them into the books of original entry. Now, in these books of original entry, we have a number of them. We have a cash book. You'll be surprised, sometimes you'll find cash book as books of original entry, but we'll also find it as a ledger. In a later stage, we'll understand what we mean by ledger. But again, or sometimes it is also called the principal books. So it acts in both ways. It is at the same time a books of original entry, but it is also at the same time the principal book of account, okay? But secondly, the other books of original entry that we're having a purchase book. Third, we are going to have a purchase return book. I'm going to explain one by another. And then fourth, we are going to have sales book. And fifth, we are going to have sales return. For example, if you're making some sales and at some point in time, you expect that there will be some return, okay? So we are going to have a sales return book. And we also have a number of them. For example, the bill receivable book. You might be having bills receivable book. If you're going to have a bill receivable book, then you might be also having payable book. That is a payable book or bills payable book. Let me shorten it by saying payable book. And lastly, sometimes you might be having journal proper. So you see, these are some of the books of original entry. One might be having cash book, purchase return book, sales return book, bills receivable, payable book, and journal proper. So let me explain one by one, and I hope you're going to give me an attention. One, let us start with the cash book. Of course, we know that we are now familiar with the cash book. You've been hearing that someone is saying, yeah, I'm going to post it in a cash book. But actually, what is a cash book? Okay, a cash book is a book which records receipts and payment. A cash book is a book that records receipts and payment of a cash transaction. So a very important note here, you're going to record receipts and payment of cash transaction. When you're having cash transaction and then you have receipts and payment, then those ones are going to be recorded in a cash book, okay? So that is very, very simple, a cash book. But again, we have a purchase book. Now these names themselves, they help to give you an insight of what actually a book will contain, what kind of information in that book. For example, the name itself, purchase book, it is a book which record the credit purchase of goods of a company. Because sometimes you might be having purchases that you've done in crediting. So those purchases of a company that has been carried on credit terms, they're going to be recorded on purchase book. Now, note that here we're going to record payment and receipts in terms of cash. That's why you're going to have a cash book. Purchase book, these are the books of original entry that we are going to record the credit purchase of goods of a company, those purchases that have been made on credit terms. And then purchase return, the name itself, there's a name here, return, but again, it correlates with the purchase book. But now, since you've purchased, then there is a return. So you expect this is a book whereby you're going to record all the returns. We are saying purchase book is a book which records all the returns of credit purchase of goods that have been undertaken by a company. So all the returns are going to be recorded at the purchase return. And again, we have another book, which is the sales book. It is a book which records all the credit sales. You expect all the credit sales are going to be recorded here. But again, sales return, we are going to record all the returns, sales return in itself. So the name at least gives an overview of what, as I've said, what kind of information or what kind of transaction that you're expected to find there. Then we have bill receivable. It's a book that records all the bills receivable. So one might be asking, what is a bill receivable? Of course, receivable is what is something that we expect. So all the bills that you expect to receive, we're going to record them into this kind of book. We have bill payable. The name payable, or the payables that you expect to pay, or that are supposed to be payable, they are going to be recorded in this book. And also we're going to have a journal proper, or the transaction that journal proper. You see, now we have a cash book, purchase day book, purchase return. So sometimes you might be having transactions that do not fit in these kind of books. So those transactions that you might not be able to fit in these other books of accounts, they are going to be recorded in the journal proper. Okay. So in a nutshell, these are the books of original entry. So I wanted to make them aware before you, and this was what was required out of this question, that you are supposed at least to mention three of them, and then to come up with a bit of explanation, trying to explain what kind of transaction that you need to find them in this books of original entry. So you see, these questions are very, very simple. With this course, Principles of Accounting, is actually this course intends you to give an overview of fundamental knowledge of the principles and rules and what is expected out of accounting profession. Okay, now part two of the question, but before I go to part two, if you're interested enough to come up with a diagram of these books, for example, cash book, so that to convince the marker or the instructor to give you more marks, you can even come up with
a diagram. For example, a cash book, you're supposed to come up and draw a cash book. This is a cash book, your right is a cash book. You have your debit here, you have your credit. This is sort of an account, it is sort of a ledger, so if you write it that way, it is okay. But again, with these books of original entry, you're going to record day-to-day transactions. So day-to-day transaction, sometimes you might have a form like this. For example, this let us assume this is a purchase day book or purchase book. So you're going to have your date here, particular here, and then you're going to record your transaction. So maybe on 1st of January 2020, maybe you've purchased a certain product, maybe purchase of furniture. Let us assume purchase of furniture, and then you're going to have if you're going to have a folio here, maybe folio number one, and then you're going to have an amount there. For example, purchase of furniture, maybe of 20,000. Okay, so it is simple like that. Then you come to the 2nd of January 2020. Probably you purchase some other item there, and then you're going to add folio number two, and probably it costed 40,000. Okay, so that is how your purchase day book should be. Now, to make it easy and give you clarity, I'm going to show you this question, only this part of the question, so that sometimes you can even pause this video and have a look at it. But actually, you are required to show the journal entries. See the instruction, you're supposed to show the journal entries necessary to record the following transaction. Show the journal entry necessary to record the following transaction. You are given a year there, let us assume that was 2018. Like 2018, the first transaction is that we bought a van on credit from Kiki. We bought a van from Kiki. We bought on credit terms for an amount of 5,395,000. Okay, so we bought a van on credit. So here, the journal entry should be because we bought van on credit from Kiki Garage for an amount as an shillingsy. For an amount, how much? For an amount, 5 million. 5,395,000. Okay. So this is the transaction. Now the journal entries, the journal entry should be because we bought a van on credit. Now we have to identify all the accounts that are going to be affected. Here we bought a van, so we expect that we are going to have a van. That's one. But again, since we bought a van, the other thing is that we expected, because we are told that we bought a van on credit. If you bought a van on credit, so two things we are going to have. You're also going to have a creditor. So here, since we have a van, we are going to debit a van. Van is an asset. And then we are also going to credit. And our creditor is Kiki Garage. Of an amount, 5,395,000, and again 5,395,000, and you're going to have a sort of narration that being a van bought by credit from Kick Garage, from Kick Garage. Okay, so this is the journal entry. So it is as simple as that way. Simple as that way. That is one that I wanted to show you. So the intention here is to show you how you're supposed to come up with the journal entries. Okay. I hope it is clear. I hope it is very clear. I'm not going to do all the journal entries. I just wanted to show you and make it clear to you, because I'll leave you this question and then you can use it. And I'm going also to, in the end, I'm also going to give you what is expected. Of course, the sample of the answer to this question, you might find a number of examples when you go to your Moodle. When you go to your Moodle account, you'll find these examples and some of the very soft examples. Okay. Now the other transaction was you were told that on May 3, because we have a debtor of an amount 81,000 owing from Masaru was written off as a bad debt. So a debtor was written off as bad debt of an amount. This is Tanzanian shillings, 81,000. Okay, so that is the transaction that we are having a debtor before, and then this debtor was written off. We're having a debtor, and this debtor was written off. Okay, so now let us see the journal entries. The journal entries of this transaction. Since we're having a debtor, and this debtor was saving an amount of this one, and then you are told this debtor was written off. So what are the transactions that we are going to have? Okay, first, if this debtor was written off, we know that the debtor account is having a debit balance. So we expect that we're going to take this amount. If it was having a debit balance, then we expect that we are going to, and our data, we are told that our data is Masaru, so we might address it as a data, or we might address it as a name by Masaru. So we are going to take this account to the bad debt. So we are going to credit the data account Masaru. We are going to credit because it was having a debit balance. We are going to credit, and then the corresponding entry should be reflected to the account of bad debt, and then from that account of bad debt, we are going to write it off. So simply, an elemental, we're saying that we were having a debtor who is Masaru, and then so we are going to debit bad debt account. We are going to debit bad debt account of an amount 81,000, and then we are going to credit Masaru or the debtor, our debtor here. Our debtor, who is Masaru, of an amount 81,000. So by doing so, our debtor account is going to be written off. Then you're going to have an expense of bad debt of this amount, because you've written off as bad debt, which means you've incurred an expense. But of course, from the accounting point of view, we know that this bad debt normally write them off from the provision, because before you come up with a bad debt, you have to set aside a certain provision. You'll understand when you go into the knowledge area 4, whereby there is an element of provisions there, you'll be able to understand these elements. Okay. Now, that is how the journal entries was supposed to be written, but I've tried to come up with only two examples. From this question, but we have a number of transactions there. What I'm going to do, I'm going to leave you with this question, and also I am going to leave you with sample answer with this question, so that at least you can be able to understand or to follow up with this transaction. Let me add you another transaction here. Let us go to party two. That we are told that the furniture was bought by us for 610, and then was returned to supplier. We were given a name of supplier that was Timeless Limited, and it was unsuitable because it was unsuitable. But I guess full allowance was given. Okay. For allowance was given. Now, if you look at this transaction that we are told that office furniture was bought by us. Office furniture was bought by us of an amount 610.
office furniture was bought by us for an amount of 610, and then this office furniture was then returned to the supplier, and we were given the name of the supplier. And then a full allowance was also given after the return. So here, you see, we are having a supplier who is who supplied us, and then we have another element of goods return. Okay, that we purchased something, then that purchase was returned. So it is sort of return outward. Okay, we purchased something, and then we purchased something that we brought furniture inward. And then we are going to return those furniture. So this is an element of purchase return, which is also sometimes referred to as return output. So let us see the journal entries, okay? This transaction. One, our supplier was the creditor. So before, when those goods was brought into us, our supplier is a creditor, so we expect that our supplier was going to have a credit balance. So to reverse it, to make it the other way out, then we're going to debit our supplier. So we are going to debit our supplier with an amount that was returned, and our amount was 610, and then we're going to debit, we're going to credit return outward. Return out because these goods were brought in that was debited. Then if we are saying that now we are going to return them out, then we have to credit the return outward account with the same figure of 610. Okay, I hope it makes sense. And you can even name here your supplier from this question that we're given. The supplier was limited. Time was limited. This is the name, so you can even write time on limited instead of writing supplier, whatever the case. But the very important thing is for you to understand this transaction and to have a proper journal entries that reflect the actual transaction. So this is what is going to be done, because now you have to come up with another account which is the books of original entry, the return outward, or sometimes it is known as the purchase return. Okay. Purchase return. So now you see how this transaction should be, or how the journal entries were supposed to be recorded. But don't forget to come up with a narration here. You have to narrate, for example, this transaction. Then you can say being return of supplies purchased. On credit, okay, from time was limited, okay. So whatever the narration that may come, but at least it should reflect what the transaction was all about, okay. up to this point, I'm certain sure that you've been able to capture and being aware of the books of original entry, especially the cash book, the sales late, the sales day book, purchase day book, purchase return, sales return, the journal proper, and the posting of these records to the journal entries. And from the examples that we've gone through, and I'm certain sure now you've been able to have at least an insight of what we mean by the journal entries of and the books of original entry. So let me take this time by saying thank you for your time, and I hope we are going to see each other in our next sessions. Thank you so much.